Okay, so in today's session, we'll see more about the Erwin tool and the features of the Erwin workspace, and what are the different features of the Erwin tool. So this is the Erwin data modeler. We have opened the Erwin data modeler, and this is how it will look. Now our requirement is to create a new model. So as we saw last time as well, if we want to create a new model, we just need to go to this button over here on the toolbar that says new, or we can go to the file icon, we can click on it, and we'll have an option called new. And if you want to open an existing model, we want to make some changes, we already have a model, we can open that model. So if we say new over here, a template would open up, and we have to select whether we want to create a logical model or physical model, or logical physical model. So we can choose any, but if your ultimate aim is to create a physical data model, it's a good practice to choose a logical and physical combination so that we can keep on seeing a combination of how the physical model is coming along as we are designing the logical model. We can choose our target database system for which we are designing, so that when we actually generate the SQL for the physical data model, it is aligned properly as per the target database. So just select logical, physical and say OK. Now this screen will open up. Now let us try to understand some of the features of this workspace that we have in front of us. So there is a toolbar over here. And these are all these options are there. If we click on the file option, we have the option to save, open, close, print. If we go to the edit, simple edit options, undoing an option, redoing an option, cutting and copying. If we go to the view option, you can see that we have selected all these options that we want to see: the model explorer, the action log, the advisories pane. So this is this over here is your model explorer on the left hand side. And you have two views here, either the model view or the subject area view. Then this over here is your, if we see over here, this over here is your action log. So whatever action you are taking, that will be logged as an action over here. So create model. And it has logged its various events and triggers. This is your action log, and this is your advisory space. So you will see once we take some actions, what kind of actions are logged into the advisory space. Now this is a particular help, the action log, and we'll see how it helps when we are designing any model. But let's first understand the workspace. So this was the view, then you have the format option wherein you can choose how you want the model to be displayed, at what level you want the entity to be displayed, relationship, you want to group, ungroup, align, your default fonts and colors. Then you have all those model specific properties, your subject areas, your entities, the attributes, key groups, whatever are their properties. You have the tools wherein you can reverse engineer, complete, compare, you can add a model source, you can build a report, you can derive a new model. You have all those options which we'll see in a later sessions. Then you have the services. Window is nothing, how you want the view, and help are your help topics. So if you want help with any of the topics related to Erwin, you can choose any of the help topics. Now this is your model explorer, and you can see that there are some default values, domains, entities. So once we design, these are the elements of the data model, of the logical data model, and those are the ones which we see here. If we change this to physical, we'll see that the elements have increased and they're more database specific now. So this is the difference between the logical view and the physical view. Logical has a limited set of elements over here. In the physical view, we have a lot more database specific elements. Now, what are all these options on the toolbar over here? This is the new, the create model, the open model, save, print, so simple options. Then what are the important ones over here? These are related to the report. This is your table view because we are in the physical mode, and that's why it's showing us the table view. If we change this to logical, it will be calling it as an entity, because that is a terminology of the logical model, that is a terminology of the physical model. So we have entity over here, we have attribute over here, we have definition over here. If you go to the physical, the same would be named as table view, column view, which is the attribute view in logical, and this is your comments view, which is description view in your logical model. Then we have the subject area. We create a subject area, we can edit that subject area. This is a select toolbar. This is your independent table or entity. This is your view table, the views and materialized views. These are your kind of relationships, identifying relationship, or you have a non-identifying relationship. If you go to the logical, you'll see this as identifying relationship. This is your non-identifying relationship. So how do you identify? Just by looking at the model, whether it is an identifying relationship or a non-identifying relationship. The non-identifying relationship is a dotted kind of relationship, so it's not a continuous line. For an identifying relationship, it's a continuous line. And this is the more important one. This is a many-to-many relationship, which we'll see, and we'll implement, and we'll see how this is defined in the logical versus the physical model. Then this is your diagram pane. Simply for the visual effectiveness of your data model, you can use all these. You can use the rectangle, you can use all these shapes and make it more visually effective and more easy for the other users or your audience to understand. So these are your diagram tools. Then when you have some element over here, you will see that all these will be enabled. So you can apply your text color, you can apply your background color, you can apply an outline color. Again, for the visual effectiveness of the model, to make it more easier to understand, to make some certain elements stand out, and so on. Then all these are alignment buttons. So again, once we have some elements over here, we'll be able to see them as activated and use them. So this is simply align your tables, align on the top, align on the bottom, simply as we do formatting in any of the Word document. It's a similar kind of formatting. Another important thing are these forward engineer and reverse engineer options. So if we go to the logical model, we do not have those options because they are related to the your physical database. So that is why they are visible in the physical view of the model. So what is forward engineering? Forward engineering is implementing the model that we have designed in the Erwin in a database. What is reverse engineering? Reverse engineering is simply taking an existing data model from a database, pulling it in Erwin, and then making changes to it. So that is reverse engineering. So we'll see more details in upcoming sessions, but that is what they mean basically. And you have a complete compare option where you can compare two data models and identify the differences. This is your target server properties. You can validate the SQL and so on. Then these are your transforms, many to many transforms. We'll see when we apply the many to many relationship, we'll see how this works. Now let's do some sample activities. Let's take some sample actions so that we know we are able to see more of these toolbars activated and we are able to use them. So let's any first step simply is while designing a data model is to add an entity or a table. So we'll go to the logical, we'll design in the logical mode, and then we'll keep on checking how it is coming along in the physical mode. So we go and select the logical mode, and then we have this entity over here. Now the very first step, add an entity. So we select it, click on it, and then just click over here. Now for entity, we saw it last time that to name the entity, by default it will be named as E/1. I want to name this entity. Now we'll take the same example that we took last time of the students and the courses that they can enroll for. So I'll name this as student entity. I'll name this as student. Now I will press a tab button to go to the primary key column. So this is attribute because this is a logical mode. And I'll define a primary key column. Let's say I define the primary key column as student ID. And now I'll define some columns. So that will be your student name and so on. So let's just define one column for now. So now this is my identity and this is how I can name the identities. Now what else can I do with this? When I'm making a diagram, I can put some color on this to highlight this identity or to make this visible separately. So I have selected the identity. I can go here and apply text color. Whatever color I want red. So it applies red color. Now this is text color. I want to highlight or fill this entity with a particular color so that I'm able to view it distinctly. So I go to the next option, which is apply background color. I can choose any color. Let's choose yellow. And this is how it will look. So this is how you can change the color, change the text color, change the background color. We also have an option to, now I have selected the student entity name. I can go and make it bold again to make it stand out. I can make it an italics. So all these options are there, simple formatting options. So I can use these options and make an entity stand out. Now let me go and add some more entities. So again, I click over here. I add an entity over here and this is my courses entities. So courses, I put a tab and I make a course ID and I make a course name. So this is my another entity I've added. I can format it differently. I can make the entity name as bold. I can put a background color again. So I'll put another color to highlight it separately. So this is how I have created two entities. I can keep on adding entities. Now every time I am creating an entity, if you look at the action log, you'll see that it is recording some events. So what is the event? Let's look at the last event that we have. So the last event is at the top and the historical events are at the bottom. What was the first event? Create model, validate DBMS version. So this is when we selected the template and we selected the target server. These are the actions we took. Then we created an entity. By default, the name of the entity was E/1. So we renamed the entity. We created some attributes, student ID, student name. Then we set the font and colors. We changed the font and colors. We created another entity E/2, we renamed it, we added some attributes and set font and colors. So every action that we are taking on the model is getting recorded in the action log. Now what is the purpose of that? The purpose of that is, let's say we add another entity, then we add, okay, and we put it as test1, then we add another entity, and we put it as test2. Now this is, I've created a lot of entities, I've taken a lot of action. Now for some reason, I want to undo to this point. I do not need these two entities now. I want to undo to this point. I only want these two entities in my data model. So what I can do, I can choose that action from the action log, which is here, create entity. And then I can right click and I can select the option to undo to this point. So if I do that, then the actions I have taken till that point, they will be undone and I only have the two desired tables or entities that I wanted in my data model there. So this is the use of action log. To undo an action, you have an option to undo to a point. So that's a very useful action in many scenarios when you want to undo your actions. You have created some more tables, you do not want to take them, or you want to restore it to a previous version. So you can just restore it till that point and undo all the changes that you have made. So this is your use of the action log. You will also see that in the advisories pane, this is your advisories pane on the right, there are certain things, there are certain advices that are being given by the tool to according to the actions that you are taking. So you have destroyed the object because you have undone your entities that you created. So it is saying destroy object. So it's just an advice just to keep you informed of the kind of actions that you are taking. Now some more formatting options are there. Now we have student ID, course ID. I can just select these two entities. And now I can see that there are many more options that have come up in my alignment pane. So they were deactivated earlier, but now there are more actions here because I've selected the two entities on my model. So we can see that this is align top, align bottom, align left, align right. So let's choose the align top and see what it does. This aligns at the top. So aligns both of them at the top. Simple, these are formatting. So it overwrote. So we will just go and undo this function. This is your undo. So these are simple alignment options as we have in any Microsoft Word document. So same option, same formatting option, only to help you align your model, help you properly organize your model. It's nothing technical, it's only for the visual effectiveness of the model. Now, this is your model. This is the logical version. If I click here, we will see that this is your physical version or the physical mode. So can you identify any differences? Are you able to identify any differences? This is your physical. These are your tables in the physical data model. And then this is your logical mode. And these are your tables in the logical data model. So the differences you can identify, see your student, you named the student ID, student name. Let's check this entity in your physical model. You can see that this is student underscore ID now. You can see this is student underscore name now. So an underscore has been placed instead of a space that we saw in the logical data model. And why is that? Because when you implement a database, a model in a database, then your table cannot have. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, so we were looking at the differences in the logical model and the physical model, and we identified that the differences in the attribute name. So in the physical model, it has by default taken an underscore because when we implement in a physical database, the column names cannot have spaces in them. They need to be continuous. So just to separate the two words of the phrase, we have separated them by an underscore in the physical data model. I'm going back to the logical view. If we select an entity and right click on it, you'll see these options. So you have your entity properties, you have your attributes, key groups are indexes, which again we'll see in an upcoming sessions, object, font, and color. So let's click on the entity properties and see what is there. So when you click on the entity properties, right click on the entity name and then go to the properties and click on it. You'll get all these options. This is your entity. This is the name of your entity, which can be changed if you want. Definition, if you want to define the entity as something that the student, or you can just define student entity consists of all students of list of all students. So you can give any description, whatever you want. This is your volumetrics. This is your sizing information. So if you have that data, you can give it that this is, these are the initial number of rows which are going to be in my table. This would be the maximum number of rows in my table. This would be growing by this much percentage in a month. You can put any notes if you want to put. You can define any user-defined properties if you want. You can define the icon. You can choose the default icon, or you can choose some other icons if you have. You want to put a customized icon. This is your history that it was created on this date in the model. So these are your entity properties, very basic properties. So the thing that we wanted to add was simply a definition. We'll just say okay. And similarly, you can add it for courses, which we'll see later. Then you, if you click on here and again right click, you will see that you have the option of attributes. We can just click on attributes. It's showing you all the attributes that you have created. You can go to the data type and see what are the data types. So it has taken the default data type of char 18. There are no constraints on these. You can put a definition on each of the attributes if you want to define. Again, going back to the general tab. So this is your primary key. You can see it over here. And the data type, as we saw, was char 18. Since it's a primary key, by default, it has taken it to be not null. We go to the other attribute, which is the student name. It has taken the default data type of char 18. We have the option to define it as not null if we want, or we can let it be null. And then it's not defined as a primary key here. So these are your attribute properties. Now I can choose whether I want to view the data type, the data types that we have, I have defined for the attribute level. And I have these various options over here. This is entity level, attribute level, or definition level. Let's see if we click on definition level, then what happens. So I've clicked now on definition level and this is my view now. So I cannot see the attribute. I can see the entity name and the definition that I gave for this entity. For the courses entity, I did not give any definition, so it is showing me as blank. So this is my definition level view. Check the physical. It's still showing the column view. This is your comments view. Let's see the comments view. This is how it looks. Let's go back to the logical model. And now I'm outside and I just click here. So now I've not selected any of the entity. I'm just clicking outside the box and let us see what are the options we are getting. The zoom in and out, simple options, your display level. Again, I can even select it from the top. What is my display level? Your entity display. What all do you want in your entity to be displayed? So you'll see that there are a number of options here. We'll see how to set these. Relationship display. We don't have a relationship here, but we can see how to, what format to choose for displaying the relationship. Now let's go to the model over here. Now I want to change the way I am showing my entities. So I go to the model over here and right click on it. and I get an option of properties. So I select that option, properties, and I can see that there are various options over here. So general option, definition, notation, defaults, UDP, etc., etc. Let's see, model info, name is model one, author, do I want to add an author name? I can if I want. Type is logical, physical, that is what I chose. Database or SQL Server, that is what I chose initially. Modeling features, is it a dimensional model? Is it a data movement model? So for now, it's a simple data model, so it's not a dimensional model, so we do not need to choose anything. Then transform options, so show source object in logical, target objects in physical. We'll see. We select this, we have some other options as well. So we'll keep this unchecked for now, but we'll make a transformation and then we'll see how changing this option will change the view. So for now, what we're interested is in the definition part. Do I want to define this model? It's a good practice to do so, because if I'm designing, let's say I'm designing this model for my HR department, then I can just put a line saying this is a model for the HR department. So you can put any notation. This is how the relationships and the entities will show as per some documented set of relationships of notations. So you have the ID F1X, you have the IE for the logical. So you have two options for the logical notations, information engineering or information modeling. For the physical notations, you have these three options. So we'll see how changing these options change your view again. So they simply change your visual view. Nothing has to do with your physical interpretation of the view. Now, what are your defaults? So defaults, these are your defaults. We saw that every time we add a column, by default, it takes the char 18 data type. Why is that happening? That is happening because that is what we have defined in the defaults. We have defined the default data type for any new column that we add to be char 18. Logical data type to be char 18, the physical data type to be char 18 as per the database. We have defined by default that non-key null option. If you are adding a non-key null option, that means a non-key attribute, then it has to be null by default. I can make it not null. So these are your default attributes which can be changed. These are your relationship defaults, any user-defined parameter that you want to add, and this is your history. So this is how your model properties look like. So if I want to, two things important here, definition, if I want to define the model. Notations are important, which we'll see later on. Defaults, if I want to change by default. So if I'm designing a model where mostly I'm reading from a file and I am reading all the columns as strings as var char 50, I can define that here so that every time I add a column, I do not have to change it manually. So all these things can be done over here. Now let's go to this view. And I want to change the view of this. Okay, so this is toolbars. I go to the format. I want to change how this is displayed. So go to the display level. This is definition. I could have changed it from the toolbar, so let it be. I go to the stored display settings because I do not want to change it every time. I go to the stored display settings. And what are these general properties? Logical model, display shadows, relationship lines, orthogonal, that's fine. Let's see what all is visible in the logical view. So we are viewing it at the definition level. That's why it's showing it like this. So we'll make it entity. Now, when you make it entity, what all do we want to see in the entity? That option is over here. So we can just click it. A foreign key designator, migrated attributes. Okay. Now, I want to see the role name or the attribute. I want to see the attribute data type. I want to see the attribute domain. I want to see the primary key designator. You can just select all those options, whatever you want to see. This is for my logical data model. Now, I click on the physical data model. And what is my display level? This is comment over here. I'll make it to table. what all details do I want to see in the table? I want to see the data type of the column that I am adding. I want to see the domain, the null option, the primary key designator. So I select all these options. UDP is nothing but user-defined parameter. Definition, if I want to define, put any definition for this particular kind of display that I'm showing. No, I don't want to do that. I'll just say okay. So what do I see here now? I had changed it to entity level. So this is my entity. I have to change it to attribute level to be able to view this. Now what has changed over here? Let's just put it over here. Now by changing all those view display options, what has changed? The way we are viewing this data model has changed. The entity name, we were able to see them previously as well. Now there is a symbol before the primary key. So this is the primary key designator. So just by looking at the symbol, we'll be able to identify that this is a key column. This is a primary key column. Easy to understand when somebody looks at the model. So this is why these things are important and how these things help. Now another thing that we have added is we have added the that we wanted to see the data type. So we can see the data type over here, char 18, and this is your default domain. So this is your domain, and we'll see we can add more domains over here. If you click on this, you can see this is your default domain. Because by default, we saw what were the default options? Data type char 18. Nullability for ID column is not null. For any non-ID column, the nullability would be null. So this is what it is showing. It's a default domain. And similarly for this, let's check the physical data model. Again, it's at table level. We go to this level and the column level, and we can see this over here. So this is your student entity. This is your course entity. You have your ID column, which can be identified by this symbol. You have your data type, char 18, default domain, and then you have your nullability over here. So this is how you can change the view. Now another thing, just for the visual effectiveness, we remember we had this diagram pane. So how can this be used? Let's take this version and let's just select it over all these, both of these two, and then fill this with some color to make it stand out. So let's say this color. Then I can go and add a text box. So this is my text box. I can define something over here. I can put something. Relationship between student and course. You can resize it. You can do whatever you want. You can put your text over here. And you can simply move it. So this is how you can keep on designing in different ways.